Turn missionary Matthew. It's good to have you home. Nice to know that you didn't get eaten by the camels. Leisha's diligently working away in the kitchen. She's made some gorgeous cookies. Well, we wanted to turn our attention for the moment right here. Hey, sweetie, what are you doing?
Haley, look, Daddy's video camera.
You're going to have to be patient with me. The camera is very operator dependent. I'm just starting out here. We got some lovely ladies from BYU, Sarah.
Lovely ladies who haven't gotten ready.
And then Melissa.
Okay.
Whoa. It doesn't go that far.
Hey, Carter, what are you doing, buddy? Carter, can you get the ball? And Graham is extremely excited to have the entire clan home for the first time in many years. What do you have, buddy?
I'm really excited that it's like 6 a.m. and you're recording us before we're ready for the next.
That's what recording's all about.
Hey, Carter, come here, honey.
Hey, babe. I love you all.
Great
lines
all the time.
Yeah.
I had that camera the whole time and I didn't even know.
Really?
You can move this.
Oh, okay.
Can you?
Oh, I see.
I just discovered that today. I wish I'd known that before.
Nice. Well, this is the Christmas Eve still. And we're watching It's a Wonderful Life. Nicole's taking a rest. Kaylee, did you help Annalisa make sugar cookies? Annalisa worked real hard to make sugar cookies, huh?
I didn't make sugar.
Brian's in there slaving away, Annalisa.
You want to try some butter naan?
No.
Yeah,
she's not worthy.
And then we have Leslie here.
She can still try some.
I tried a little bit of that when Jeff got back from his own brother.
Matthew's diligently trying to clean up the house. Christmas Eve, right? Getting ready for the Christmas Eve ball. Who will win? Who will win is the question. Who do you think's going to win tonight, Jared?
Well, whoever does the best fake out.
Who's going to win the Christmas Eve ball? I hear you're a top contender.
Me?
Yeah.
His room tonight. It's Christmas Eve and he's hiding out in his room. Dad's in bewilderment, wondering what's going on in his last son's mind tonight.
Do you want something to eat, Peter?
He's anxious about Santa's visit. He's anxious about Santa's visit tonight.
Santa, don't visit the funeral home, little buddy.
Oh,
yeah. Jared, you got some crackage going on.
We got the table set and everything's ready. Been working diligently. Brian's got a fantastic program plan for us tonight, too. That's a full Nelson. You can't get out of that. You can't get out of that. You can't get out of that full Nelson. They're working hard here. Carter's eating. Carter, how is the food? Hey, Carter, how's the food? Kaylee, tell me about who's coming tonight.
Santa!
That's long and
wide. That's so nice. Must be Santa.
Santa!
The full Nelson has just been released. This is Christmas Eve dinner tonight. Peter, we're grateful that you've joined us. And look. Well, I thought I heard the door, if it was Leisha. Waiting for Leisha to join us. There's Peter. He's had a tough last few hours. Brian's been working diligently with the program. Melissa, Leanne, Matthew, Michelle, and Aaron. Jared, how's the food, Jared? What do you think about the food, Jared?
He doesn't have any food yet.
You don't have the food yet? There's lovely Nicole, my wife. Carter looks like he's all done. Dad. Some nice roasted vegetables. Some fruit. Some broccoli. Which is brain food. So we're waiting for Leisha to get home. And it will be very, very joyous when she...
Tape last.
It's Christmas! Christmas Eve! He's backing away. He's doing music. All the stockings hung by the stairway with care. Look at all these presents. Peter's.
We're not gonna open presents till like 8 in the morning.
Peter's perusing all the presents. Learning what they got under there for him.
There's no reason not to sleep in.
Excuse me.
Peter, sleep in if you want.
I am going to.
Getting the house ready for the program. Just what?
This part here, so that you can move the camera and be able to see whatever.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
Okay. That's good to know.
Do
evening.
You know where the zoom is?
Yeah, I do. It's up top. It's the Christmas program here.
So the pressure's on Brian tonight, huh?
Brian's been screaming.
You gonna make it over there?
Uncle Bido.
Yeah. Hi.
There they are.
Did you say Tony? Did you know?
That's a little close, dear.
We're extremely excited about this program.
You got
who are we missing?
I'm gonna make people sick again.
Elder!
Yeah, me too. So we'll just go there. So.
Oh, he's gonna. You're gonna conduct and lead and sing.
And I said unto him, to know the interpretation thereof, for I spake unto him as a man speaketh. For I beheld that he was in the form of a man, yet nevertheless I knew that it was the Spirit of the Lord, and he spake unto me as a man speaketh with another. And it came to pass that he said unto me, look, and I looked as if to look upon him, and I saw him not, for he had gone from before my presence. And it came to pass that I looked and beheld the great city of Jerusalem and other cities, and I beheld the city of Nazareth. And in the city of Nazareth I beheld a virgin, and she was exceedingly fair and white. And it came to pass that I saw the heavens open, and an angel came down and stood before me. And he said unto me, Nephi, what beholdest thou? And I said unto him, a virgin, most beautiful and fair of all other virgins. And he said unto me, knowest thou the condescension of God? And I said unto him, I know that he loveth his children, nevertheless I do not know the meaning of all things. And he said unto me, behold, the virgin whom thou seest is the mother of the Son of God, after the manner of the flesh. And it came to pass that I beheld that she was carried away in the spirit, and after she had been carried away in the spirit for the space of a time, the angel spake unto me, saying, look, and I looked and beheld the virgin again, bearing a child in her arms. And the angel said unto me, behold, the Lamb of God, yea, even the Son of the Eternal Father,
We'll have a thought by Alicia.
He's the center focus of my life. I think growing up you kind of focus on yourself, and you may not think you're selfish, but you really do tend to focus on yourself more than on Christ. And I just know through this family and through my mission that I grew to know my Savior and love him and put him first in my life, because without him you can make some pretty stupid decisions in your life and just it'll seem kind of rocky, but when you put him first things tend to even out. And I know that he's our Savior, and that if we're faithful we can live with him again.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
We're going to sing O Come All You Faithful.
You sang twice today in church already.
Yeah, we did sing twice.
I didn't sing it
yet.
Well, she took over every good song, so I said, gosh darn, I was going to do Joy to the World, and they just did it for Prelude.
I love Joy to the World.
We enjoy it.
Okay, we're going to do all three verses.
It's a great anthem to come to worship.
That there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria. And all went to be taxed, every one to his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth into Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David.
Thank you. We're going to have Leanne's going to share her favorite part of Christmas with us.
Okay, what I could think of about my favorite part of Christmas is just, like, the spirit of Christmas, like, how everyone has a lot of charity in them. Like, they're giving, and they focus more on Christ. And I think that's my favorite part, like, to focus more on Christ, because, like, we need it in my life. But I just wish that we could do it every day in my life. Like, not just from around Christmas time, but every single day. But I just love the spirit of Christmas, and just, like, the love we have to our Saviors, and how we celebrate Jesus Christ's birth. So I think that's my favorite part of Christmas.
Thank you. Okay, we're going to sing A Little Town of Bethlehem, and then we'll all sing again.
Recording?
Yeah, I'm recording.
Oh. Okay.
Why not? Savior is coming, but in this world when angels
will see him still. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn.
We're going to have a little musical number with Nathan. And he's going to sing us a song.
It hasn't even started yet.
I'll have you know this is my first official musical number.
Could be your last.
I like to dedicate this song to Aaron Bradley Clark.
Wait, I don't know how to sing or anything.
I am a man forgotten. No one recalls my name. Thousands of years will fail to fully erase my shame.
Shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over the flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and glory to the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid.
Thank you. Melissa, if you could share your story now.
From the inside. Our hero at the grocery store. Christmas stories happen in the most everyday places. I was part of one not long ago at the grocery store. I hope I never forget it, though the memory is bittersweet. I had been shopping for almost an hour by the time I got to the checkout line. My two youngest sons were with me, the four-year-old refusing to hold onto the cart, and the two-year-old trying to climb out of the basket and jump down to play with his brother. Both got progressively whinier and louder as I tried to keep them under control, so I was looking for the fastest lane possible. I had two choices. In the first lane were three customers, and they all had just a few purchases. In the second line was only one man, a harried, old young father in his own baby crying, but his cart was overflowing with groceries. I quickly looked at the three-person line again. The woman in the front was very elderly, white-haired, and rail thin, and her hands were shaking as she tried unsuccessfully to unlatch her purse. In the other line, the young father was throwing his food onto the conveyor belt with superhuman speed. I got in the line behind him. It was the right choice. I was able to start unloading my groceries before the elderly woman was even finished paying. My four-year-old was pulling candy from the shelf, and my little one was trying to help by lobbing cans of soup at me. I felt I couldn't get out of the store fast enough. And then over the sound of the grocery store's cheery holiday music, I heard the checker on the other line talking loudly, too loudly. I glanced over as my hands kept working. "No, I'm sorry," the checker almost shouted at the old woman, who didn't seem to understand. "The card won't work. You're past your limit. Do you have another way to pay?" The tiny old woman blinked at the checker with a confused expression. Not only were her hands shaking now, but her shoulders too. The teenage bagger rolled her eyes and sighed. As I caught a can of soup just before it hit my face, I thought to myself, boy, did I choose the right line. Those three are going to be there forever. My mood was positive, and I had my sugar against getting my food. But the smiling woman directly in line behind the elderly lady had a different reaction. Quietly, with no fanfare, she moved to the older woman's side and ran her own credit card through the reader. Merry Christmas, she said softly, still smiling. And then everyone was quiet. Even my rowdy children paused, feeling a change in the atmosphere. It took a minute for the older woman to understand what had happened. The checker, her face thoughtful, hesitated with the receipt in her hand, not sure whom to give it to. The smiling woman took it and tucked it into the elderly woman's bag. I can't accept, the old woman began to protest, with tears forming in her eyes. The smiling woman interrupted. I can afford to do it. What I can't afford is not to do it. Let me help you out, the suddenly respectful bagger insisted, taking the basket and also taking the old woman's arm the way she might have helped her own grandmother. I watched the checker in my line pause before she pressed the total key to dab at the corner of her eyes with a tissue. Paying for my groceries and gathering my children, I made it out of the store before the smiling woman. I had made the right choice of lanes, it seemed. But as I walked out into the bright December sunshine, I was not thinking about my luck, but about what I could not afford. I could not afford my current self-absorbed frame of mind. I could not afford to have my children learn lessons of compassion only from strangers. I could not afford to be distant from the spirit of Christ at any time of the year, especially during this great season of giving. I could not afford to let another stranger, another brother or sister, cross my path in need of help without doing something about it. And that is why I never hope to forget that Christmas hero in the grocery store. The next time I have a chance to be that kind of hero, I can't afford to miss it.
Great story.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that was a good story.
Sarah, you could share your thoughts on what Christmas means to you.
Okay, so Brian asked me what Christmas means to me, and so I looked it up on Google, and it said something about... It said something about a season that is usually used to celebrate the birth of Jesus of Nazareth, and usually presents are associated, something like that. And I was thinking about it, and I said, no, that's not it at all. Okay, this is Christmas, all of us together. Christmas is a time for family, and usually I like Christmas to be associated with music, because music just touches me a lot. And at the base of all the songs that we sing, the thoughts that we hear, Jesus Christ. And he is what we're doing. We're celebrating Christ's birth with our own families. And that's what Christmas is to me.
Thank you, sir. Okay, now. We're going to sing another song. Joy to the World.
Like this one's you, Aaron.
Aaron!
Oh! Here, we cannot afford to let this opportunity pass.
Both of us, we were pumped. We wondered why.
We can't have everyone. Well,
you're the only two.
He wasn't pumped. Only Aaron.
I wasn't invited.
No,
I'm
Aaron
so
read before.
Luke, what was that?
Luke 2, 10 through 14.
It's in the
Testament. Should be marked.
Really dead.
Just checking to see how things are in Mongolia.
You read the New Testament, whether you read the book of Numbers. 10 through 13?
10 through 14.
Peter.
And the angel said unto them, fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men.
Peter's going to share what he likes about Christmas.
Well...
yes?
What I like about Christmas is how everyone gets together and has fun, and we get to celebrate Christ's birth, and yeah. That's pretty much it.
What do you really like about Christmas beer?
Family.
It has nothing to do with the food that you eat, or... The presents that
the
you receive.
The spread that you know.
So we don't have to worry about that presents at the...
Yeah, we probably don't have to.
How'd you feel about buying presents this year?
How did it feel to prepare? Buying presents and giving. Because it's a good feeling.
What kind of feeling is good? Is that Peter?
Peter's got presents for everybody this year.
That's awesome.
I don't know.
There's no socks in there, Peter. I'm gonna be kind of mad.
You're gonna be mad.
Well, yeah.
Okay, you guys are focused on him a lot.
We demand a lot of him. He's the last child.
He's supposed to be
the perfect prototype of everybody else.
Right?
Blended into one.
See that picture there on the piano, Peter? All you have to do is look better than that.
Aaron, I started out with.
You're the one that's smiling in the photo. You have that look.
Okay, we're gonna move on.
It wasn't so bad until my father decided to put that in the paper.
You put that in the paper?
I don't remember that. I
get a headshot of Aaron. Oh yeah, here we go.
I'm getting punked rather regularly now. It hasn't made the blog, unfortunately.
Red Star one of Matthew?
Matthew's around the corner, too. He's got a third grade one with macaroni around it or something.
Yeah, he's got the macaroni going.
Who's Red Star tonight?
I think it's
the Stephalano.
Okay.
Nobody has anything like my candles there on that tree.
Well, we're going to proceed now. We're going
to
have Michelle and Sarah sing a duet for us.
Duet.
Yes, Michelle's beautiful. Thank you. She's
a little
shy around us. We've been waiting.
She'll be great.
How many? 6 years for this, Michelle?
Be respectful.
They are such an intimidating bunch.
Yeah.
Lucky,
you're like a wallflower among us, right, Michelle?
Okay.
Sorry for the shakiness here.
Matt moved.
Would you like us to turn around and pretend we're not listening?
No, this is good.
Okay.
Just like when they told me to play the piano when I was 12 and I hated it.
This is just like that.
Thank you.
are his Joseph.
And when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem, saying, Where is he that is born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east, all Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he demanded of them where Christ should be born. And they said unto him, In Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet, And thou, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, art not the least among the princes of Judah, for out of thee shall come a governor that shall rule my people Israel. Then Herod, when he had been privily called the wise men, inquired of them diligently what time the star appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, Go and search diligently for the young child, and when ye have found him, bring me word again, that I may come and worship him also. And when they heard the king, they departed, and lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them, till it came and stood over where the young child was. And when they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And being warned of God in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed into their own country another way.
Nikki B.
Nicole and Mom.
The hips don't move anymore. They just don't.
Thank you.
blessed of all, which we give of him, that he lives. For we saw him even on the right hand of God. We heard the voice bearing record that he is the only begotten of the Father, that by him and through him and of him the worlds are and were created, and the inhabitants thereof are begotten sons and daughters unto God.
All right, I'm going to play you guys Silent Night, but what I want you guys to do is just to take this time now to sort of think about what you wanted to give Christ for Christmas. I just want you to think about that. And just think of Christ and think of the words. I don't know, just want you to sort of feel it.
You want my turn? That's so it's proper. Something today, and it never really had to. And the last few months, when I was on my mission, I did everything I could to try to develop the attribute of charity. And I understand that attribute takes a lifetime to attain. Even in that time period, many aren't able to do it. But I was able to realize that that is our goal here, that the family. The main way that we attain it is through the family and through the atonement of Christ that we're able to attain it. And I'd just like to say I'm sorry for the hardships that I've caused. And that my new goal is to maintain good communication with you all and to get to know you personally, because frankly I really don't know you all terribly well. And I feel that would be very beneficial and help me to learn from you all and
I think it would help us become stronger as a family. That's why I sit there in circle.
Thank you.
It's hard for me to say. I've been thinking about this. I've just been going through a lot of hard time with everything. I'm sorry that I've been so rude to people. I'm very need to work up being kind to others. It's just so hard, but you're so busy and everything. It's just, I really want to learn how to be kind because I've been hurt so many times. It's just in my life, I should really want to learn. Open up, communicate, and share my love ever. It's not very easy. I just wanted to let all you guys know that I love you guys, and I'm sorry that I've hurt you guys in the years and stuff. I'm really sure sorry, and I really, really want to be kind and just learn how to love each other and stuff. And just express our love to everyone. So I really wanna work on try really hard to show my love to other people. Just I'm gonna really try working on it.
We love you too.
can you record the rest? Just hit this button to start it. And try to be as steady handed as you can.
Well, when I heard about this challenge, I was thinking, well, there's lots of things I'm going on, but I really need to improve my relationship with some of my siblings, such as my sisters, a couple in particular. I'm not the most patient person. I'm going to try to be more patient and better communicating, and briefly not, and to show more love and not be such a, punk, but I'm going to try. And don't miss it. Don't just miss it.
Thank you.
Okay, for this challenge, I was trying to think, and I really wanted to work on the gift of charity because even though I can be nice to people when I first meet them, but I'm not always nice when I meet them again. I'm usually quick to judge people, which is a really bad habit. So I am trying to be better towards others and be kinder to people when I first meet them. I have been reading my scriptures more often and praying to Heavenly Father to have the gift of charity every day. And in doing that, and then I've grown to love my Savior a lot more because He's always there for me when I need Him. And He's the ultimate example of charity. So every day, I tried to have his picture in my mind as I go through my day, and things have gotten better. And I love you all.
We love you too.
I'm older than most of you. In fact, all of you except for my parents, I think. Back in March, we came out here for conference, and at the time, I was dissatisfied with my life, in particular with my job, which seemed to be causing most of the strife I was feeling. In large part because of that, and it's amazing how the Lord works, because that dissatisfaction is what has led to everything good that has happened since, and to joy which I still can't believe that God has given me. Over the course of this year, since March, I have been steadily increasing and exercising faith and in striving to know the Lord's will for what He would have me do, and praying fervently for those inklings I've had of what I think is, are His will. And today it seems miraculous to me that we sit here and I have this perfect job that seems to be everything I've ever wanted, that we can afford it, and that I have two beautiful children, and a kind, kind wife. For Christmas this year, Nathan's thought, my goal has been to take better note of and respond to and write down the promptings I've received from the Holy Ghost. And I can tell you that having started to do that, it has blessed me immeasurably. I have found more strength to turn off TV shows that I probably shouldn't be watching, and to stop watching them altogether. I've said things that I'm otherwise not inclined to say, either because I'm afraid of hurting someone's feelings or because it would be too awkward. I feel happier than I have ever been. And I tell you that, and I am 28 years old, but I've been trying since I came home, since I started my mission, to become the kind of person that you all tonight have spoken of who you want to be. And I'm not there yet, but I can tell you that I feel closer than I've ever been. And in large part because of that, I'm happier than I've ever been. And I think in that, I have also increased my ability to make others happy, to bring them closer to Christ, because I feel that my will is more aligned with His. And I feel my power to do His will has increased, and my courage and my desire to do it has increased immeasurably. I know that God is a rewarder of them who diligently seek Him. I also know that He is kind, that He gives men the desires of their hearts, and He will bring us back to Him. And not only will He bring us back to Him, but along the way, He will give us more joy than we can hope for. But we need to trust Him. We need to trust Him enough to keep His commandments. Sometimes that means keeping our mouths shut when we feel inclined to give a stern remark or to respond with a cutting sarcasm. To trust Him to do those things that He would do, to sacrifice ourselves and to make an offering of our whole souls to Him. If we trust Him, and we can trust Him, He will make us happy. And I can tell you that because He has made me happy. And I say that in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
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 Actually, before Nathan did the challenge, I, back in July, when I started planning for Christmas, I made it a goal for myself to try and focus a little more on the Savior this season, and also to try and be a little more trusting, a lot more trusting. I worry a lot about things I don't have control over, and I'm really independent in that I just always feel like I need to do everything by myself, and I always want to do it perfectly. And so I've just been trying to be not so worried about the things the Lord has in store for me. It's been nice this Christmas. We've read scripture stories about Christ every night and things like that, and tried to take moments here and there to read talks or whatever to focus a little more on the Savior and a little less on all the business and the things that are fun but they're not central. But I felt like I haven't been able to put my whole heart into it the way I feel like I should. But it's been interesting to me that even my little effort, how I sense the Lord reaching out to me. There's so many little things, I guess, that I thought of in the last month.
And I feel like
a little bit better about saying my will be done. But, anyway. One thing I've noticed, though, I guess through this, is, I always worry about what the next big trial is going to be for me. And, but I think something that I've really learned this season is just seeing like everything's come together so perfectly. From Aaron's job to everyone being here together and all the events falling into place. I can't believe how everything's come together without a hitch, and I felt lately how the Lord wants us to have times like this too, that we can be happy and enjoy life, and that it's okay to enjoy that, and that He's aware of us and He's involved in our lives, not just when we struggle and when we're desperately in need of His help and trying to reach out to Him. So. And then also,